This episode is brought to you by Dashlane. Try Dashlane Premium free for 30 days at www.dashlane.com/infographics and never forget another password and keep all your online accounts secure. It's the height of the Cold War, and 300 meters beneath the surface of the stormy North Atlantic, a Soviet submarine steams past the Icelandic coast. The Soviet captain looks to his crew. Everyone is holding their breath, waiting to find out if they've slipped past the formidable NATO anti-submarine picket line that stretches from Iceland to mainland Europe. After several tense minutes of silence, the crew relaxes. Sonar can hear NATO patrol ships far away, but not a single one of them has changed course. They haven't been detected. Ordering his men to hold bearing, the captain plots a course a few hundred miles from the American coastline, where his nuclear ballistic missile submarine will loiter undetected, ready to deliver a devastating surprise nuclear attack in case of war. This is how the balance of power between the two great superpowers is kept. Neither side is able to completely eliminate the other's nuclear arsenal completely without being destroyed in kind. Settling in for a long 3-month patrol, the Soviet crew breathes a sigh of relief, knowing they successfully fooled NATO's anti-submarine patrols. Yet unknown to the Soviet sub, a predator stalks the deep cold of the Atlantic, just a few hundred meters behind them. A 370-foot beast made of high-tech steel and aluminum, manned by the US Navy's finest soldiers. The Russians are good submariners, but their subs lack sophistication, and unbeknownst to them, a powerful American underwater weapon can detect them from clear across the Atlantic, zeroing in the US Navy's hunter-killer subs onto their location. For decades, Soviet nuclear attack submarines believed that they're prowling the oceans of the world undetected, completely unaware of the hidden killers always following their every move. If a nuclear war ever broke out, the Soviet ballistic missile submarine fleet would never get a chance to join the war, eliminated in minutes by the hidden assassins keyed onto their locations by an incredible piece of American technology, the Sound Surveillance System, or SOSUS. Very rudimentary passive and active sonar systems existed as far back as World War I, but these early systems could only manage detection at distances of a few thousand yards, and even then only under the most favorable conditions. During World War II, sonar technology barely moved past these rudimentary systems, and much anti-submarine surveillance was based on visually identifying the vessels by air as they loitered near the surface to recharge their batteries or bring up their periscopes to target ships. During the 1920s, though, the development of the sonic depth finder was an important first step in developing more advanced and capable sonar systems. Although the various elements of a modern sonar system would not achieve technological maturity or be truly understood until halfway through the Second World War. In 1937, Lay University scientist Maurice Ewing made a critical discovery which would catapult American sonar technology far ahead of its competitors. While doing seismic refraction experiments in water 3 miles deep in the North Atlantic, Ewing used explosive charges placed at different depths to generate sound waves. As Ewing listened to the echoes of the explosions, he discovered that sound signals at very low frequencies could travel great distances with minimal loss, and he postulated that in certain conditions, so-called deep sound channels could exist which would propagate an acoustic signal for hundreds or even thousands of miles. At the same time, the invention and refinement of the bathythermograph by scientists at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology and the Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution made possible for the first time the continuous measurement of ocean temperature at various depths, and more importantly, how fast the speed of sound varies at different distances below the waves. A growing understanding of how underwater sounds are refracted or bent by variations in the sound's velocity caused by different temperatures and depths helped support Ewing's hypothesis that underwater channels could indeed propagate acoustic signals for as much as thousands of miles. Wasting no time, the Navy immediately authorized a slew of tests for developing these deep sound channels for military use, although at first they would only be used for communications. During the spring of 1944, Ewing supervised a test using the USS Buckley, which steamed away from a receiving ship, dropping explosive charges set to blow at various depths. By determining the pattern of explosions and the depths they occurred at, the Navy hoped to build a system of communication that was impossible to jam and only required a receiving ship to have nothing more than a basic hydrophone. The explosions from the Buckley were clearly discernible until at last the Buckley had to call off the test after reaching a distance of 900 miles and still being clearly heard by the receiving ship. The test was a huge success, and a system for helping locate and rescue downed pilots was immediately developed. Named SOFAR for Sound Fixing and Ranging, the rescue system consisted of nothing more than a downed pilot dropping a small explosive charge down to the depths of the deep sound channel, where an underwater system of hydrophones would pick up the explosions and triangulate the pilot's exact location. Too late in the war to be of great effect, the rescue signaling system was nevertheless a huge success, but some minds in the US military slowly began to see an altogether different potential to this quirk of underwater acoustics. After World War II's end, the US Navy continued to establish major SOFAR networks in both the Atlantic and Pacific Oceans, investing in the future security of its downed pilots in case of another major war. Yet, as the first chills of the Cold War began to grip the world, the growing threat of a Soviet submarine fleet based on captured German designs urged Navy leadership to develop a more formidable anti-submarine warfare capability based on the detection of underwater sound. By the early 1950s, the US government believed that Soviet submarines posed the greatest threat to American security over any other Soviet weapon, and thus established Project Hartwell. For 6 months, the best and brightest minds of the American Navy and civilian scientists alike drew together to discuss how to counter the Soviet submarine threat. Long-range submarine detection was premier in the list of topics discussed during Project Hartwell, and a focus of its efforts. The physicist Frederick Hunt electrified the project heads with a stunning and very convincing idea. Why not use SOFAR to detect Soviet subs? He showed Project Hartwell's leadership that higher frequency sounds made by Soviet subs could be easily detected at ranges of a few hundred miles, but frequencies below 500 Hz would easily penetrate through the various layers of the oceans to reach the deep sound channel from virtually any depth, and thus make detection of a noisy Soviet sub possible at ranges of thousands of miles. The US Navy immediately started several highly secret research programs to better understand long-range sound transmission through the ocean. They even partnered with AT&T to begin building underwater listening stations. This budding secret surveillance network was classified with the acronym SOSUS, standing for Sound Surveillance System, and received a top secret classification. In January 1952, the first prototype SOSUS installation was deployed by a British cable layer, and after a series of successful detection trials with US submarines, the Navy approved the installation of more arrays along the entire American East Coast. 2 years later, a system would extend to the West Coast and to Hawaii as well, ensuring that no hostile sub could approach the US mainland without being detected. The early SOSUS arrays were fixed directly to the seafloor at specific locations that could access the deep sound channel and oriented at right angles to the expected approach axis of a hostile submarine. The outputs of each hydrophone was transmitted to shore processing stations through multicolor armored cables. At these shore-based processing stations, the incoming data was analyzed and observers would look for the distant frequencies given off by rotating machinery. Hundreds of printers at these facilities would output infographics 24 hours a day, constantly monitoring the entire ocean for Soviet signals. Observers would look for distinctive submarine signatures printed on the graphs, and if simultaneous contacts were made with multiple arrays, then a target could be verified and its position triangulated. Moments later, a US sub or surface boat would then be dispatched. SOSUS had originally been designed to detect air-breathing Soviet diesel submarines, which would have to surface to snorkel depths to run their diesel engines and recharge their batteries. However, the system's ability to cover a wide range of frequencies at nearly any depth would prove even more effective at tracking deep-diving Soviet nuclear-powered submarines. With the first SOSUS contact on a Soviet nuclear boat west of Norway established in 1962, SOSUS would go on to play a major role during the Cuban Missile Crisis, when it detected three Soviet submarines leaving Russian waters heading for Cuba. In 1968, SOSUS made its first detections of Soviet Charlie and Victor-class submarines, proving its worth even against upgraded Soviet designs. It even allowed for the discovery and secret retrieval years later of a Soviet Gulf-class submarine that had sunk north of Hawaii. The US Navy had a silver bullet in its arsenal, and with it the ability to completely shut down the threat of Soviet submarines. Yet the secret of SOSUS wouldn't last. In late 1967, US Navy Chief Warrant Officer John Anthony Walker strolled into the Soviet embassy in Washington and sold a top-secret radio cipher card for a few thousand dollars. His treachery directly led to the North Korean attack on the USS Pueblo while in international waters, an act which was later revealed to have been coordinated by the Soviets, who wanted access to the encryption devices stored aboard so that they could make full use of John Walker's leaked intelligence. Aboard the Pueblo, though, the Soviets discovered some details about SOSUS, and through subsequent spying soon discovered the fact that their submarines had been tracked almost effortlessly for 2 decades. Immediately after the John Walker betrayal, Soviet submarine designs became much quieter and thus harder to detect. SOSUS continued to operate, however, until the end of the Cold War, and in 1993, with the threat of Soviet submarines nothing more than a memory, the system was turned over to civilian researchers who adopted it for studying whale migrations and communication. In 1996, SOSUS's big brother, the Advanced Deployable System, became operational, as the need to monitor the world's oceans for new threats once more became vitally important. The U.S. Navy has some of the most advanced technology in the world, and that includes top-tier cybersecurity tech to keep them safe from hackers. But in today's ever more dangerous world, you need the same level of tech to keep yourself safe, because hackers are a threat to everyone, especially individuals like you. With Dashlane, you can rest easy knowing that it's the one and only tool you need to keep you and your personal info safe and protected. With an easy-to-use VPN, password generator, and breach alerts to warn you when your logins have been breached, Dashlane is actively working to keep you protected across all your devices and online accounts. We love using Dashlane. We suggest you start using it too. Head on over to dashlane.com/infographics for a free 30-day trial. And if you use the coupon code infographics, you can get 10% off a premium subscription today. If you found this video interesting, may I suggest you check out our other video, Why Living on a Submarine Sucks. Also, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe for more videos like this.